Hello, everybody.
Hello, guys. Nice to see you.
I have just driven back from Norwich to London to. Apparently, there's two Surrey Quays. So, there's the Surrey Quays I live in, and there's one that's about 100 million miles away that took me through.
Oh, wow.
That took me through the congestion zone. So that was great. That's something to look forward to. I always love doing things like filling in the congestion zone.
Oh, that reminds me of the time we were in Cardiff and I booked us into a restaurant and there was lots of us as well. And I was really pleased that I could get us in. And then when I started looking at the directions, I realised that I booked us into a restaurant up in Macclesfield.
Oh,
which had
gosh.
The same name. It was awful.
What are the two ferries that leave for Ireland from Wales? There's two ferries, isn't there?
Well, there used to be Swansea to Cork, but that no longer runs. But there is Holyhead. Hollyhead to Rosslare?
Yeah, Holyhead was one, and there was another one somewhere else. And we were supposed to be on the Holyhead one, and we went to the wrong one. And we had to spend a night in a hotel where you could see the kind of dust spores in the air. And I just spent the whole night sneezing. It was great. And I'm going to have to do the same. I'm going to put on my New York traffic cop hat because it's freezing in here because I also left the windows open. So it's a fucking brilliant. I'm having a brilliant time.
You amateurs, you don't know how to winter.
I know. Okay, so we have a lot to talk about today. Stop laughing.
I know, but I can't take you seriously now.
Where's the other ear? That's what annoys me. It's got to look like there's two ears coming out. Hold on a sec. I'll work on that. So we don't start just laughing all through this. Let's talk about some recent events because we don't have Helen for long, but it's been such a momentous day again that I think that it's worth, there we go. Now we've got two ears, so it doesn't look as silly. So we've had a couple of things happen today. One was first of all, let's start with the good news. Yesterday, J.K. Rowling did a brilliant thing. She opened up a women-only rape crisis center. Now, can you imagine such an enterprise? You know?
I mean, honestly, the woman is a force of nature. I mean, I think she's got, you know, she's controlled the whole thing. I think she conceived of it. She sort of started it up. She, you know, got some amazing looking women involved. Yes. And she's funded it. And I think she will continue to fund it. So it's not going to be a charity. So no one can close it down. And yes. It is incredible that, it, you know, this is such a female centered thing. And the reaction is, you're only doing it out of spite to men. Yeah. And you're like, how is it possible that people can think of it that way?
But here's the thing.
Sorry, carry on.
Sorry, Helen. The brilliant thing about these kinds of operations, J.K. Rowling has just done one, and Posy Parker and Venice Allen, of course, are old hands at doing this. And what it is, they do something that no normal person in the UK could find offensive, and most people would actually find brilliant and think, that's a wonderful thing to do. They find things like this, like, let's go on Speaker's Corner and have a regular place where women can speak, right? Let's open a rape crisis center that's for women only. Perfectly normal, rational things that are women-centric and focused on women's safety and privacy and dignity. And always, these abusive men who call themselves trans rights activists come out on the attack, and it's a brilliant thing to see every time they do it. I've done one whole blog post on their responses to this, which range from just, you know, psychotic to illiterate to disgusting, and I can do a whole other one. And it's not just randos on Twitter. It's you know, people who are supposedly the adults in the room. So it's a fantastic enterprise all round, and well done to J.K. Rowling for allowing it to happen. Sorry, Helen.
But how astonishing that we have to do that, that women in Scotland have to do that, that all these rape crisis organizations that are already there, all of this infrastructure has been taken over by the trans lobby and the gender ideology movement. And so they have to go and build their own separate one. And even that gets attacked. You know, there's always this rhetoric like, oh, if you don't like sharing, then why don't you go create your own spaces? But whenever people do, they get attacked anyways. So there's such a raging
hypocrisy. I've actually been really quite shocked at it. You know, like, but the openness where people are pretending, you know, I'm still amazed at how people will allow themselves to look stupid. They will deliberately make themselves stupid to argue the point. But how are you going to tell?
Oh yeah,
the people coming in are cis women, and you're like, is it possible that people can't understand that service providers have got experience in targeting their service for a particular group of people? Like, you've got kindergartens or, you know, nurseries, they target their services at a particular group of people. It'd be like, how can you tell that these are actual children? How can you tell that they're children? And these are just the questions that are being asked. But instead of saying, all right, that's a good thing, it's all about the pretense that they really care. That some poor abused, like, I've actually seen somebody say that you're going to ask some poor abused woman, the first question you're going to ask her is whether she's trans. And you're like, well, no, like, the first question you're going to ask her is, like, is her name and is she okay? And there's just, and does she need help? And what can we do? And it's just lost. It's lost.
Yeah, it's always lost. And that also brings me
shocking.
That also brings to mind, I have to say, and I don't want to start up any wars again, but when Posey did her her Brighton thing, the thing that was lost there in all the ensuing kerfuffle were the voices of the women that she's platforming. You know, it's like basically they do everything they can to problematize and to draw stink around a certain thing. And it works. It just works time and time again. Now people will think, oh, has J.K. Rowling done something bad again? What is it? And they won't, you know what I mean? There's so many people saying she has that they think, oh, I don't know, maybe she has. They're the dumbest fucking people on earth who fall for this stuff.
The idea, too, that they have to ask someone whether they're female or not. The whole point is we don't. Everybody can see if you're trans or not. And if somehow you pass so well that no one can see, then as Helen has said before, there's not going to be an issue then, because you're just going to quietly move in and quietly move out. And, you know, but no one ever knew about it.
No one will ever be the wiser.
But there is one thing.
But the problem is these hulky men who are obviously, like, you know, as Ophelia Benson calls them, the bears, you know, the obvious bears who are menacing. When they come into your space, you know they're male, and you have a right to say nope.
But what if they're people who pass, like, you know, someone who passes as invisibly as Sam Brinton, or someone whose sexuality is so hard to define as Sam Smith? What if they're like those people, those magical people, like Evie Izzard, that magical trans woman person, who we all thought was a cross-dresser, but then turned out to be one of these magical new people, you know?
It's like they don't know how to draw an exact precise line. They don't know how to draw an exact precise line. So they just have to throw the floodgates open to absolutely anyone. That's the actual logic on the other side, is we don't know how to draw a perfect and precise 100% no-fail line. Therefore, we should just open the floodgates to any old fetishist who wants.
Yeah, yeah. Therefore, we just throw our hands up in the air and say, we don't know. But, you know, instead of saying, what about these, you know, what about these border cases? I mean, that would be a decent question. And then, you know, the answer probably would be somebody comes to the door and they sort of talk to them, they bring them in. And if they think that they're not suitable for this service, they will recommend them to another service. They will point them to a different service. Exactly. It isn't fucking rocket science, is it? It really isn't.
And here's another thing they do, the brilliant concern trolling that they do when they talk about, what if a woman is there with her son? Will you? And it's like, no, the son's not allowed in. Do you know what I mean? It's like they are the dumbest. I'll say it again. The fucking Father Ted musical isn't being made because of these dumb arguments. And people like Dara O'Brien and you know, Jolie and Mom and all the rest of these fucking idiots who are like, oh,
I mean, what about their dog? What about if the woman wants her dog? What are you going to do then? What if she wants to bring her dog with her?
Exactly.
I mean, that's the level of the argument, isn't it?
You're like, do you know what their arguing style is like? It's like when there's an episode of The Office where Ricky Gervais is asked to pretend to be a customer in a hotel, and he's complaining, and he's just kind of trying to the other guy is just trying to get them into a kind of role play thing, and then finally Gervais, you know, he can't get this guy's attention, so he says someone's been raped. Do you know what I mean? So it's just pulling imaginary situations out of their arse to win an argument. Do you know what I mean?
Exactly. Yes. I know what you
priceless.
Mean.
Priceless. Yeah. You know, and that's what I mean by what I said at the start of the show. I've said a lot of fucking stuff in this app. Everything that happens has an equal and opposite reaction in this fight. You know, if a good thing happens, there's an equal and opposite reaction. As we see with J.K. Rowling. But if a bad thing happens, like the Scottish result, there's an equal opposition, an equally opposing thing, like the Scottish result, which I believe, and maybe Helen, you know more about this than I do, because I was trying to ask Marion Calder today, but she's always busy, what the upside to this was. Do you know what it is?
Not really. No, I've been busy at work today. But I think the thing is.
Oh,
is
I put you on the spot. Sorry.
No. I think the answer is that nobody can now say that there is no conflict here. You know, there is a conflict. Mm-hmm. With people who have a GRA. So when people say, "Oh no, it's just bureaucracy; it doesn't make any difference," I think say, "Well, actually, there is. You know, yeah. There is a problem with it. Therefore."
Basically, this is the self-ID killer with any luck.
Well, yes. I mean, I think, you know, legitimately somebody could now make the point that actually this does matter to women and therefore use it as a basis to say, let's repeal it.
Yeah.
Can we back up a little bit and explain this to us foreigners?
Yes. Sorry, Artie.
Well, Dennis has succinctly put it in there. The upside is that the Scottish Government have been saying GRA reform doesn't change any legal rights. This judgment says it does. So,
and this judgment was made by a judge in Scotland.
So this was a judicial review, I believe. Judicial so yes, review. A judge. Yeah.
So okay. so is there?
This is a judicial review that was set up in.
This is a Scottish one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this was a judicial review that was set, that was ordered in the build up to the reformation of the Gender Recognition Act in Scotland. I presume. Is that right?
Yeah.
Sorry.
but I did vaguely, I mean, I read a few paragraphs that, you know, people were screen grabbing. And, you know, I mean, I understand that it's difficult to understand sort of legalese anyway, but there's a lot of like sex and gender going on. You know, there's one paragraph where I'm thinking this seems quite circular to me and really, you know, almost deliberately obfuscatory in a way that it's possible that you kind of don't want people to understand.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that was my reading of it.
But that's more like a trans rights activist technique. That would be weird for a judge to be doing it.
Well, I mean, you know, it is just simply possible that I...
Actually, let's see what Dennis thinks. Dennis, do you think, if you're watching the show, I don't know where you are.
Yeah, he's in. He's in. I can see him in the
comments. Yeah, I know he's in, but he might be in a park again.
Oh, yeah.
Dennis, can you tell us, is this, by the way, Dennis, you're welcome to join us and chat about it if you are around. We can park it even for a few minutes and come back and have you on. But Dennis, what do you think? What was the thing you just suggested, Helen?
About the obfuscatory language.
Yes, the obfuscatory.
Obfuscatory language, yes. Yes.
Is the language in it, Dennis, in your opinion, normal lawyerly legalese, or is it? Oh, he's around. Great, we'll bring him in. Let's ask him that in person, and then we can come back to it. Okay, so we'll come back to that in a sec and remind me of that question. Oh my God, it's so cold. It's so bloody cold. okay, hold on a sec. I'm just sending Dennis that link. All right. There's one other thing I want to talk about before Dennis gets in. Have you seen the incredible circling of the wagons around Yoel Roth?
Yeah.
Have you seen Arnie? Do you want to explain what this is?
Yeah, so this guy was the, what was he, the head of security and safeguarding, or he had some security position, I
Safety
forget.
and trust or something? It was something
Oh,
trust.
the Trittas. Trust and safety. Yeah, trust and safety council. It is,
And famously, trust and safety, there were problems because they've been dragging their heels on removing content that was harmful to children, that seemed to be exploiting children. And it turns out the guy who was the head of this had this crazy PhD that was pushing for
Now,
underage children to get on Grindr. He was trying to
yeah.
frame it like it was all queerazoid, hocus pocus nonsense. And he
Yeah,
was trying to make it
it's
downplay
making
the
it a
whole
safer
Grindr as a
space,
sex
Dennis.
app.
It's making it a safer space. That's the argument. It's making it a safer space for 12-year-olds who want to get on Grindr,
Yeah, it's
you
just
know?
such a red flag. And he was clearly like, he's very porn addled in his in his own Twitter content, just always talking about being drenched in porn all the
It's
time.
all about
And
porn. It's
also
hilarious.
making inappropriate jokes again that seem to veer into to suggestivity around sexuality in minors, which was just like really, really inappropriate if you ask me. So, again, not surprising, these people, they because they identify as queer and everybody thinks that's the new vanguard of progressiveness, they're getting put in all these positions where they're in charge of safety and safeguarding, when they're actively working against it. It's really scary, you know? And it's one of these things where it sounds like a conspiracy. It triggers so many people to think that you're accusing gay people of being predators, which is the, which is, I've been
That's
hammering
what
this
they
for this
depend
entire
on.
time,
They
that
depend on
the
it.
gay rights movement needs to make sure that predators are kept out of it so that it doesn't undermine the rights of gays and
Exactly.
lesbians and bisexuals and trans people. And the
And
TQ have to do the same thing. If they want to push their TQ agenda, they have to keep it, they have to call out the suspicious and shadiness that's seeping into it, you
Exactly.
know.
And here's, but here's the problem,
Of
right,
course,
with
it's also it's just suspicious and
that.
shady all the way down at this
Well,
point. I don't know
exactly.
if you
Yeah,
noticed that.
it really is.
And some of
Yeah.
the major players and the major voices are suspicious and shady. Look at Amy Challoner. Amy Challoner was at the heart of Reddit. Amy Challoner is
How
exactly the kind
many
of person
times?
you were
How
worried.
many times have we seen it happen? How many times have we seen that, when something is really so centering the whole, like, men basically, and trying to silence women, and trying, like throwing them out of like the Lib Dems, throwing them out, like how often have we seen that behind it there's
It's
some
some
shady
fucking
fucker?
guy whose bedroom
Yeah,
looks like
there's
a
some,
rubbish
like, where
heap.
there's some porn going on.
Exactly, exactly.
Constantly,
Hey, listen,
constantly,
I just got to get my glasses because these are my
constantly.
faraway glasses and I need my near glasses. Give me one second.
And you need your really small or really
Small
faraway
glass.
glasses.
Yeah, that was the reference.
Yeah. Oh,
Oh, I've got the
obviously, I
cough
have
that
to just
never, the
explain
cough never.
the joke.
So what were we just, oh yeah, we were just talking about that guy, and yeah, we can never, the idea that any group is immune
That
from
was really
accusations
annoying.
of there being
Oh God, that
problems
was
within
so
it
annoying.
is dangerous. You know, if you suspect that someone who within the LGBTQ or just the LGB or just the TQ or anything else is being suspicious, never should you hold their identity as a reason to suppress any suspicion. You know what I mean? Like that's dangerous.
But
You
it
can't let
happens,
that happen
it's just
ever,
happened
you
so
know?
much. I mean,
We
like, look
want
at
the same
mermaids.
level of scrutiny as everyone else, not less.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We don't want
Yes.
to be more scrutinized just because we're gay or lesbian or bisexual or trans identified, but we don't want to be exempted from the basic rules of safeguarding that everyone else is subjected to, you know?
No,
There's that
it's very dangerous,
overcorrection.
isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, do you remember when there was this huge sense of celebration when they failed to put expanded GPS checks or back, what are they called? Back, no, that's not it. GPS, that's the thing that helps you.
Huh.
That's the fucking thing that took me to the wrong Surrey Keys.
Yeah,
I'm talking about background checks.
background checks. Yeah.
Didn't they complain about drag queen story hour wanting to extend or improve the background checks? And they were like, no, you're just saying that because they're gay. And speaking of
Yeah.
just because he's gay, let's bring in Dennis. Hello, how's it going?
Pretty good. Winter
Good.
is coming, guys.
Yay!
Uh-oh.
Excellent. Now we got Game of Thrones. We got so many things going on in this episode. It's
oh, how typical. You don't want us to see your background. You don't want us to check your background because you're gay.
Just full of pornography. I'm like that bloke from Twitter, mate. It's just full of reams. How did he ever get enough time to ban anyone, that bloke? Hey? Yeah, it used to be like he was on a marathon wank. But...
I know. It was like, I mean, his, it was... What did he say at the meeting? He said something, porn will run again or something like this.
You know what it reminds me of?
I may have just shouted, porn will run again at Twitter or something. It's like, what the fuck? This is the head of trust and safety.
It's incredible.
That's just what you want to hear when you go into work.
They couldn't remove any of these dubious accounts because it was just too bureaucratically difficult. Of course they could. It reminds me of the Catholic Church when they were trying to... take away the disrobe or whatever. That's exactly the wrong term for all the offending priests.
Defrock
the offending priest. And the Catholic Church said, "Oh, it's just bureaucratically impossible. We can't do it. We can't do it." But then a nun showed some mercy to a woman who needed an abortion to save her life or something like that, and they're like, instant excommunication, instant defrocking. So yes, like, yes. When it's on their side, they can do it in the snap of a finger, automatically, without even having to stamp any pieces of paper. But if it's a man molesting children, and it's like the Twitter guy being like, all these women speaking gender critical truths, they're getting kicked off at the snap of a finger. But if like there's this abuse of children going on, they're like, oh, there's so much red tape. We don't know how to do anything about this.
Yeah, yeah. Someone just said it was 50 million views of one piece of child abuse material on Twitter. And then that guy goes and it disappears, you know? And what's amazing, Dennis, and this is what I wanted to talk about, I'd love to get your opinion on this as well, is like these guys, like it's not, I find a little bit frightening. We were talking about conspiracy theories earlier, but I did a Google search on Noel Roth and every single story from mainstream outlets was saying, using phrases like smear, Elon Musk smears, every single one, I'll try and find a thing so I can read some of them out, but every single one of them was weighted to protect Roth and cast Elon Musk as a bigot. I was astonished to see. I mean, here's the thing. I was quite surprised to see it happen to me. It led to a few changes in my life. I was astonished that it happened to J.K. Rowling. I find it extraordinary that they're going after Elon Musk in the same way. You know,
it's almost as if a few people are worried, isn't it? I mean, that reaction tells you a lot, I would have thought.
But what's strange about it is that it's lots of kind of people who've never mentioned a trans issue. It's a lot of journalists who've just been looking the other way. You know, like they don't, they're not like trans rights activists. They're proper major journalists in places like the Washington Post and the New York Times. And they're all casting aspersions on, you know, bear in mind, I think the COVID thing was a bit of a fuck up. But like, you know, I do think.
Yeah, Elon always cloudies the waters because he's always being an eccentric and kook. And he's kind of like, I agree with him about some things and I totally disagree with him about other things. And he's just always tripping, touching on all these topics.
The mistake of reading an American story as a British story. Like those COVID lines and so on are not, you know, I think vaccine uptake in this country, for example, was 97-98%. It's just not an issue here. In America, it's very different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's just it. The Elon Musk thing is interesting. These Twitter files are unfolding are an American story.
And over there, it's explosive.
Yes.
And I think that's what accounts for the mainstream media that you've looked at, Graham.
Oh, no, Dennis. Dennis, this is American outlets. This is American outlets.
That's the point.
Oh,
that's
sorry. I see what you're saying. Okay. Yeah.
But, you know, like Musk is sometimes, you know, some of the things he's done and said, you're like, So you could, and when he took over Twitter, you know, there was that huge fuss, oh, it's going to fail. So people kind of want to also jump on that bandwagon and say, oh, look how terrible he is. Look, he's fired everyone. He's making them into dormitories because everyone needs to sleep there. So, you know, people are just going to look at something he's done and say, and find the negative in it regardless.
Exactly.
So I think there's some of that going on too. But
he's fired the porn guy. Oh, I know.
Like all he wanted to do was think about porn all day while telling women to not say okay groomer. Fucking unbelievable. And they've been, and again, they've all been caught. And there's this interesting time after they're caught where they pretend, oh no, no one was caught. This is just normal. All you, everything you're seeing is just the way gay people are. I'm sorry, but gay people do not bring pornography into work with them.
Please.
You know?
Oh my God, no.
I can't remember mincing into the Crown Court with a pornographic calendar to put up with behind me.
With a Tom of Finland gift, Christmas gift for your favorite judge. Fucking hell. But listen, let's go back to
The four women Scotland judicial review. Yes. Yeah, yeah.
So Dennis, in your view, the Helen was saying that she thought the language was a little bit hard to parse. Is that because it's legalese, or is it?
It's quite difficult legalese, because what you've got here is a judicial review, which is about statutory construction. And what that means is, what do the words in an Act of Parliament say? And that should be simple. It should be straightforward, common sense language. But the trouble is, once Acts of Parliament start not making sense with each other, which the GRA and the Equality Act do not, you start to have to look outside of them and look at other authorities to try to make sense of them. And the story starts in this case. I've only just recently read the judgment. I probably won't pick up the finer points, but in a nutshell, it comes to this. The 2004 Gender Recognition Act contains the dreaded Section 9, which I don't think anyone thought of at the time. Just to give you the context, the 2004 Act, we had to pass because we got in trouble with the ECHR, because our legislation, our law, was not adequately protecting trans people, said the European Court of Human Rights. So this piece of legislation is passed at a time when not many people get GRCs at all, so it's quite widely drafted. And the dreaded Section 9 says if you get a GRC, your gender becomes, it says you acquire all the rights of the opposite sex, and the important quote is, for all purposes. All purposes.
Okay.
That's really wide. Yeah,
yes.
Super wide. And if anyone took that literally at that point to mean for all purposes, it would drive a coach and horses through everything from pensions to equal pay to anything. Like, there's lots of legislation that depends on this. So we fast forward and we get to the Equality Act. Now, the Equality Act then sets out the protected characteristics that you can't discriminate against, and they include men and women. And at the time it's passed, I think there's an extremely good argument to say it means biological men and women, because if you go to section 212, quote, this is the definition, subsection 1, quote, woman means a female of any age, bit of a clue there, and man means a male of any age. Now, to my mind, the case should stop there. Section 212 is a complete answer to this judicial review. In addition, the Equality Act contains single-sex exemptions. It contains times when it's okay to have a single-sex service. That only makes sense as a statutory provision if you read sex in the Equality Act as meaning biological sex, okay? So that's just that's my own view on it. But Lady Haldane doesn't agree with me. What she says in this judicial review today is this. She goes hard on Section 9, and she says that the for all purposes has to be read as for all purposes. And if the Equality Act had meant the sex to mean biological sex, it would have used the word biological, which it does not. So that's why Four Women Scotland end up losing this judicial review. But we end up in quite a strange position, because as Helen's already said, you've got this problem already that the Scottish government are off saying our act won't change anything. Well, Lady Haldane's just said it will. She's just said it's going to change a lot. Right.
Yes. And also, sorry, just a reminder as well of the classic moment when Ruth Hunt and Owen Jones agreed it was just admin. Yes, I hope to see that as a GIF used a lot. You can actually find that on Twitter as a GIF. if you just Google admin Owen Jones. Anyway,
just getting on with some admin. I'm just changing my gender.
Then I might go for a swim in Hampstead.
Pick up some bread.
Pop in the rape crisis center for a laugh.
And do you know what? I might pop in and run one, actually, Graham.
You know what? You dream big, Dennis.
I should. And meanwhile, you guys can all go reframe your trauma.
Okay?
Let's talk about Wadha. Let's get onto him in a bit as well.
The issue here, I think, is this. What you're left with at the end of this JR, because you've got this very interesting paragraph, I think it's paragraph 56, and it says, look, although I've decided that this is what sex means in this judgment, it doesn't mean that it always means this.
Oh, Jesus.
Sensible, eh? Okay. That's going to really help for understanding the law. Because the court says, well, sex could mean a different thing in a different act. And as an example, here's an act of parliament about intimate searches. Mm-hmm. And in that context, sex can mean biological sex. Now, what this has done, I think, in Scots law, therefore, is create a presumption that unless an act says biological sex, it means geo-acquired sex. Now, if that is the case, there's a lot of old statutes where no one would have thought to use the term biological because it wasn't even an issue, right? There's an awful lot of old statutes where we're going to have problems. So what you're going to end up with, I think it's the worst of all worlds in some respects, is case-by-case litigation about what sex means. I think some Scottish lawyers are disagreeing with me on this, but I think there's a good appeal to be had here to the Court of Inner Session, the court above this, to say, well, it's all very well to say Section 9 for all purposes, but we've got this Section 212 of the Equality Act. I repeat, woman means a female of any age. I mean, it might as well have said adult human female, gone all posy on us, you know?
It's
pretty bloody clear.
To say woman means female is to say that there's a nuance in the word female that is explicitly biological. Mm. They wouldn't just say woman means woman if female just means woman, because that would be circular. When they're saying woman means female, they're saying that word female has an added element of definitionness to it. Definitionness, that's my new word.
It's good.
And that is the biological implication, presumably, right?
I mean, I do think, I would say, we've got to watch this space. Please remember, For Women Scotland lost the first time round on a similar judicial review, okay? Mm-hmm. And they won on appeal. Always remember, Maya Fostata lost first time round. Yes, remember, law is a bit slow. Always remember here, this could be pyrrhic and self-defeating for the Scottish government, because all of the communications with MSPs now, I'm involved in some lobby group communications where we are saying, read this judgment, because everything the Scottish government has told you is wrong.
This
confirms what we've been arguing about it. So it's paradoxic. I mean, gender always abounds with paradox. It's paradoxically helpful from that point of view. It's also, frankly, blunt forced this issue, because this has come on a day when the bloody Cambridge Dictionary redefined woman.
Okay. Before we go on to that, Dennis, can I just quickly ask about that? There is, I once threw a shit fit over something like this, and then someone said to me, "This is the Cambridge Dictionary online. It's not the Cambridge Dictionary. This is different." So I could be wrong, but maybe there's people in the comments who might be able to help us with that one. But it might be something to definitely cause a stink about it, but I have a feeling that you won't find it in any actual written copies of the Cambridge Dictionary.
Okay, good.
You know, but I could be wrong.
It has had the effect, though, and I don't blame several of the women who I've seen online with my new, recently and probably temporarily acquired Twitter account.
Well done for that. That's hilarious.
I heard you, by the way, in the last episode. So yeah, how long are you going to have it for? Let's see. it has, I think, rightly, seriously speaking for a moment, made a lot of people very angry and very worried. And there's a lot of women now looking at this saying, well, we're being defined out of existence. And frankly, if that makes people speak up where they haven't before, maybe that's a good thing. You know, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean,
it's had to happen.
Yeah. But I contacted someone from For Women Scotland because I was amused at their tweet yesterday, which went, our result comes in tomorrow! Exclamation mark. And I thought, why are they so happy? Do they know? So I tried to find out whether they knew. And they replied, oh, no, it's just win-win.
Well,
you know?
That was one of their first remarks, wasn't it? This MSP point. So, you know, look, it is statutory construction, judicial review. In many ways, it's quite a dry judgment. We're not thrilled with this outcome, but don't let anyone, particularly on social media, behave like a football hooligan supporting their team and tell you this is 100% for them. It's not.
Yeah. Okay. I'm changing the title of this episode again to Dennis Kavanagh brings pretty good news.
I think that'll do. Okay, news.
Dennis, can I just tell people that Dennis has a podcast that is essential listening, which is The Queen's Speech, which I recommend you look at. We'll put in the link below.
Thank you.
But is there anything else you need from us before you before we shunt you out the back?
I would like to very briefly say this, if I may. There's going to be a consultation in the new year about the teaching of gender in schools. Gay Men's Network will be producing one of our responses, and everyone else will as well. So just keep an eye out for that.
Okay.
And thank you for having me.
Thank you for appearing on such short notice. It's great.
No worries. Yes, that was lovely, Dennis. Thank you so much. That was really helpful.
Cheers, Dennis.
Great to see you again.
Take
Dennis.
Care, guys.
Bye.
Okay. Now, listen, I'm sorry, but may I bring up, this may be, I wish I should have actually told you to look this up before you both came on, but you may know about it already, you may not, I don't know. Has anyone heard of ChatGPT?
Yes, I've been using it for weeks.
Oh, no, I forgot you were in fucking IT. Of course you know it, sorry. Listen, I found an interesting thing when I used it. Now, just to explain, ChatGPT is what people are saying is a kind of transformative piece of technology, the way Google was or the iPhone was, because what it is a AI that responds to spoken commands. So you can say, write an essay for me on the relevance of Shakespeare today, and it will write a very basic essay, but that makes sense and is full of good points and has never been written anywhere before. It will do that for you. And
I tried it. I asked for a 1,000-word essay on some aspect of economics, and it really did it. And it was actually not bad. Not bad at all.
Did you give it any follow-up commands? Because that's the fascinating thing.
You can say
to it, make it shorter and better.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, you can make it, and also it can write code, which I think is extraordinary. You can say to it, make me a, someone did an example I saw, it said, make me a starfield, like those old screensavers where you're traveling through a starfield, you know?
Yeah.
And it just gives it a go, and it was wrong. Yeah. And he says, no, that's wrong. And it just does it again. And it just keeps reiterating until it gets it right.
It's so scary. This thing can debug code. So somebody provided it with a line of code that had a bug in it, and it said, find the bug. And not only did it find the bug, it explained in detail exactly why the bug was a bug. And then it offered a solution to the bug. I was just like, I can't believe it's doing this.
It didn't help me this week, though, with my Excel issue that I had.
It does Excel, though.
Yeah, I know. It like just VBA didn't help me. The answer it gave me was wrong. Like, I mean, I'd already tried that and it was wrong. And I told it was wrong. And it was like, oh, apologies. Yeah. And then it tried something else, but it wasn't right. But it did write me a nice winter jazz song about Santa and mistletoe. So that was good. With a bridge and everything.
Well, let me tell you. Was that a but, Helen?
Well, yeah, there is a bet. Its training data is quite one-sided in some ways.
It certainly is. That's what I did. You do what I did. I wrote in something like, can you explain to me the gender critical position or something like that? And it was heavily weighted on the other side. But is that what you mean?
Yeah. Well, in fact, like a friend of mine today, you know, we went through sort of asking question and then saying, actually, you've just given us a tautology there And he's like, oh yeah, so I'm sorry about that, but yes, this is what a tautology is. And you're like, but you know, we're talking about what you've said. And basically it was about, I think this one was about pronouns and the use of pronouns, and it was very heavily weighted. And then, so we asked, can you give us an argument for the other side why you wouldn't use pronouns? No, I don't have any arguments like that.
I am
simply a chatbot. I don't have any access to the internet. My training data has only given me this. And that was really interesting.
But what's really interesting is it's full of arguments for why it's a good thing.
Full of it.
So I believe that one of the things that it's doing, Helen, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that it's learning also from input, isn't it? The more we input into it, the better it does in terms of these results. So what I was going to suggest on this show is, I know it's terrible, like a lot of people are saying it's negative, it's going to kill jobs and stuff like that. I'm afraid, yes, this is one of those things that's going to change society.
Yeah, this is pivotal. This is a pivotal moment. Although, I mean, I thought it was incredibly pivotal until it couldn't actually answer my questions. And then maybe you haven't quite passed. But it's all about, it's just about the training data and it's still in training mode. You know, it is people are still sort of testing it and we're helping it. At some point, of course, it is going to have access to the internet.
Exactly. I mean, it's a little bit frightening. It's a little bit Skynet and all that sort of thing. But I was thinking in the short term, perhaps if people are going to use it, because everybody's going to be downloading it and trying it out and playing with it, in the short term, teach it some fucking turf positions, ladies. Get in there and talk to it and tell it and you know, what is a tautology exactly, Helen? It's one of those words I've heard a million times, but I can't remember what it is. What is it?
Well, you know, this is contentious because it's contentious. We ask, why is it a contentious issue? It's contentious because it's contentious and emotionally upsetting to some people. And you're like, well, you've just used a tautology there. Tautology is. And then you're like, yeah, we didn't ask you what a tautology was. We told you that you'd actually just used one.
But perhaps the way to think to teach it is to teach it the, or is to say something like, here is the gender critical position. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, that's probably a good thing. It's been programmed for some, to say in many cases, I'm just a chatbot. I cannot give you an opinion on that. I think it's not free for all. There are some limitations, it's been specifically programmed this way at the moment anyway.
When you take it all together, the circling of the wagons around Joel Roth and the kind of, I saw Boing Boing, which is a website I used to love, but apparently it's drinking the Kool-Aid as well. And they were trying to present Elon Musk as a bigot as well. And it's just so fucking interesting how so much of society is set up to ram this stuff through, whether we like it or not.
Especially in North America, it really goes to show that, you know, so much of the news that we've been covering on the show has been out of the UK, and this is an American story, and the way it's covered in the US media and the way it's reacted to by the US left is so different. I'm really feeling that, having just spent all that time in the UK and I'm back in North America now, I can just really, really, there's a real weight of, it's just such a different atmosphere here. The left-right tribalism is so serious here. Even when people are sympathetic to the position, to the gender critical position, there's a lot of wariness and worry about being tainted with perceptions of being on the right, with perceptions of being associated with, you know, Trumpism and things like that. There's just such a deep tribal divide between left and right that permeates North America, and the media in the US and Canada is just so sure of itself and certainty that if they're on the left, they're on the side of good. And they're so sure of themselves that they don't scrutinize their own side anymore. They are just openly partisan. They're openly pushing things, suppressing stories that don't align with their tribal, group. It's really a darker place here than the UK right now.
Sure.
I'm so sorry. I've got to exit.
Helen, you have a meeting. You're far away. Thank you so much for doing
one of those. Yeah, absolutely. And lovely to talk to you. See you soon. Let's do one before Christmas. We need a Christmas special with our hats, okay?
Absolutely.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, Helen.
Do we still have a couple of minutes?
Let's do that. We agreed with Helen that the boys would take over. Now we can do whatever we like.
Can I talk about that? there's some silly nothing burger of an organization, which is probably just one person, called Translucent.
This is so hilarious. Funny. Yeah, go on.
Made this grand announcement that they have some academic paper by a real life researcher that's going to show that there's a biological route to trans identity.
Yes,
that there's proof of a biological essence to transness. Yes. Well, of course, immediately a bunch of trans people were like terrified of this because if there's proof that someone is, if there's a biological benchmark for being trans, there's a biological benchmark for not being trans. So everybody freaked out and said, "How, you can't do this," because they're all basically saying, I'm not going to pass whatever test you have. I'm obviously not going to pass it.
Exactly.
You know?
And who were the voices raised raised in talking about this? I believe Lisa or Lucy Montgomery. Oh, no, what? I keep calling her Lucy Montgomery. Lucy Montgomery is the name of a brilliant actress who played the trans woman in The IT Crowd, an episode banned by Channel 4.
Oh, that's
while they promote Jordan Gray, the man who grew breasts that he could masturbate with.
Everybody's saying they're all openly kind of admitting that, once there is a threat that there may be biological measurements around trans identity, they all start screaming and shouting that it's a choice, you know?
Yes.
But also it's so funny, the organization later announced, or just this morning I think announced, that they're withdrawing the paper, they're not gonna release it after all. So it's either, there is biological evidence for some people being trans and for others not, but we're going to suppress it because the activists on our side told us to. Whole thing's made, like, it's a clusterfuck in every possible way. If it was true that they had discovered biological markers for transness and chose to suppress them because trans people don't want you to know that they don't have them, that's just as bad. Like, if the whole thing's just a clusterfuck across the board. And it goes to show that once you try to actually scrutinize this scientifically, it's just not even possible to get started scrutinizing any of this scientifically.
Yes. Yes, unfortunately, that also applies to proper science. You know, there's been a real chilling effect on science. These things should be investigated. There should be, for instance, I'll give you a very good example. There should be thorough investigations into puberty blockers. And the reason there's not is because every time a scientist tries to, he's jumped on by the same people who jumped on the translucent thing. You know,
yeah.
So and one of the other reasons, let's remember this as well, Artie. It's not just that it's important to always keep the definition of trans as loose and incoherent and obscure as they possibly can. It's also so they can continue calling people transphobic, and so they can continue putting people through 8 months of hell, like the Norwegian feminist who we interviewed, whose name has jumped out of my head. I'm so sorry, but
I was just looking at her tweet, Christine something. She's so
Christine. Today, she found out that the police aren't going to prosecute her because, of course,
not. Congratulations to her. That's fantastic.
Yes, God bless you and well done. I'm so delighted. And she just basically tweeted something like, "A man can't be a lesbian," and she has had 8 months of the Norwegian police after her. You know, so this is a kind of tool used by some of the worst people on earth: groomers, sports cheats. Fetishists, predators, political movers like Owen Jones. This is basically, the word transphobia is a weapon used by these people to destroy their political enemies. And the reason another reason you will never see a biological test for trans people is because then they wouldn't be able to call everyone they like transphobic, even fucking J.K. Rowling. You know, so
completely. It's so true. Yeah, it's really dark. It's just completely tribal. But I love this unrelated. But I love when there's just a little ping in the media that's a little bit on our side. Mm. And last night I was binge watching the new season of The White Lotus.
That's a secret tariff if ever there was one. Go on.
Yeah, so we talked about the first season of The White Lotus last year on the show because it was Mike White, is that his name, who created the show?
He's a genius. He wrote the best children's film of all time, which is School of Rock, and possibly one of the best films of all time, in my opinion.
And the scathingly insightful psychological and social drama, The White Lotus. Mm. And the first season had a very clever, snarky dig at gender ideology in that the villainous character was very prominently seemed to be reading Judith Butler's Gender Trouble, and she was using her sort of woke political views to manipulate things. So I thought that was very clever. And this season, there was just a little line where a nice, very sympathetic character, she meets a guy who's like normal and she's relieved.
No spoilers, Ernie.
Oh, he's, yeah. What's that?
No spoilers, just, don't forget.
No, it's just a line where she just says, oh, you know, he's not non-binary. Like, thank God. And just a little line like that, that makes us, that's like, oh, he's not, that one line had so much in it, had so much weight to say, he isn't absurdly self-involved. He isn't, you know, out of touch with reality. He isn't all of these terrible, obnoxious things that it's all about bourgeois people being obnoxious. I just thought, it was a perfect little, bonbon.
I call these things smoke signals. You know, there's been a few. And you know what? If people were following my blog, please do send me any you spot like this. It's all very interesting when you see artists trying to break free of their bonds. Another example that I mentioned a lot because there's so few of them is Stefan Stevens mentioned autogynephilia in a song, right, which is really interesting, you know. Anything else that we've missed? Anything else that we should do before we... I got to warm this fucking house up. My God, it's so cold. I don't know. Two windows open, the whole place has become externalized. It's like...
Oh, you guys got all that snow. I saw pictures. You guys got almost as much snow as we did over there. And
yeah, it's very pretty. It's very, very pretty. Oh, I see people saying, hi, Kara. Kara, hello. How are you doing? Thanks for watching. Absolutely disgusting what happened to you in at that protest.
Oh. Kind of unbelievable.
We will get you on. Kara, would you like to pop in for a quick chat before we finish up? Helen might be. Would Helen be angry at us for having Kara on?
I don't think so. We've had Kara on before as well, and it's always a pleasure to have Kara on. And what that was amazing. This was. Oh my goodness. What's his name again? Dana Rivers's sentencing hearing. Was that what it was?
Oh yes, I definitely want to talk to Kara about that. Let me see. I'll send you the link. And Helen, if you're watching, I'm sorry we spoke to Kara without you. We will. I will also ask her to do Wine with Women I'll guilt her.
Has Kara not done it already?
I hope not. Because that's my leverage.
I don't think so, but
that's my leverage for Helen not being angry at me. Hold on a sec. I'm just trying to find this freaking link. Hold on a second. Do that, and then we'll
see. While you're doing that, I'll do the background. Yeah, so Dana Rivers is the trans-identified male who was part of the Michigan Women's Festival protest camp, Camp Trans. These were, by and large, autogynephiles who were harassing these lesbians because they were excluding men from their private social event. And Dana Rivers, it culminated in Dana Rivers brutally butchering two lesbians and their 18-year-old adopted son, stabbed them countless times and set fire to their bodies, and just horrible multiple murder of lesbians and their family, and who I believe is trying to be censored. Now, this is where Kara comes in, because this person's just been found guilty, it's my understanding, and is now... in the long, drawn-out legal process in the United States, I guess is headed for a sentencing. And I guess there's going to be a decision on whether this man gets put into a women's prison or a men's prison.
And, of course,
because we're living in upside-down clown world, a bunch of people who self-identify as progressive and on the left are on the side of the man who murders lesbians and their families.
Yeah. Yeah,
And think that anybody who thinks that this man should receive an appropriate sentence in a men's prison is an evil bigot. And
we should make clear we're not talking about John Ronson specifically here. We're not talking about John Ronson specifically. Sorry, that was a gag. Go on, Ernie.
Yes, because John Ronson, of course, did an appallingly sympathetic podcast about the trans-identified males at Camp Trans who were dedicated to harassing lesbians and completely covered over the scandal and the tragedy of the whole thing.
It's an extraordinary broadcast. It's actually It's actually worth listening to show how someone who is as craft, as kind of like he's a very good craftsman of these types of documentaries, but how when you've been corrupted, how that turns into propaganda. It's really worth listening to for that reason. Kara, have you? Hello, thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can hear you perfectly. Yes, that's great. And can I ask, have you heard John Ronson's podcast, or have we spoken about this before?
We've talked about it, but I have not listened to it. But I know what you're referring to.
It's extraordinary. I really would recommend it because it's a fantastic example of what we've been talking about today, which is the extraordinary kind of protective shield that's put around these people. Like, for instance, first of all, there's been, as far as I can see, no reporting of the Dana Rivers case. John Ronson certainly doesn't mention Dana Rivers in his podcast. And yet it is one of the most horrific murders I think we've ever seen.
So it's worse than no coverage. So for example, from my tracking it, I think the media did a fairly decent job of covering it from 2016 to 2018, when the media just went silent. And then more recently, there were pieces right before the trial in People magazine and the Times, the Los Angeles Times, which were very tepid, but they at least mentioned the case. And both reporters got in touch with me, and I had hour-long conversations with both of them, and they both promised me they would continue to cover it through the trial, and they went dead silent too. Wow. So it's worse than just a lack of media attention. It's a deliberate burial of a really horrible case. They know what they're doing. And then I spend an hour on the phone with these people educate them about the case. And that becomes a complete waste of my time. I mean, I'll keep doing it, hoping to break through, but it's pretty dreadful.
It sounds to me, though, from what you're describing, I don't want to get too sidetracked by the reasons certain people do certain things, but it sounds to me that in that particular case, it sounds like they were interested initially, at least enough to speak to you, and then perhaps the result of the story going out was, don't write another one of those fucking stories, it's too much hassle. Would you say that might be the case?
I'm sure, yeah.
That's interesting, isn't it? So Kara,
what's going on right now? Like, you were at a physical protest with some banners in the state of California in a courtroom because Dana Rivers, I believe it's at the point where this person has been found guilty and is now facing sentencing. Is that right? Can you fill us in on where we're at with that and what you were up to and what happened?
To the extent possible, yes. A very good friend offered to fly me out to California for the closing arguments and the verdicts, which I did. That was back in November. And the verdicts were read very clearly guilty of murder in the first degree for killing Patricia Wright, Charlotte Reed, and Benny Wright, as well as one count of arson. No question about that. The confusing part for me as a former criminal defense attorney is that now they're considering insanity. I don't understand because as far as I understand from my criminal law training, insanity is an affirmative defense, which means if you are found criminally insane, you are not guilty by reason of insanity, but he's already been found guilty. So I don't quite understand how this could be. However, I have heard that California state law allows for this, and California being California, I guess I just have to throw up my hands and say, this is crazy California.
Yeah, yeah. By the way, there's one of these rare people has actually turned up in the comments, and I love these people who compare white men to black people. That's a really great argument. Keep making it. It's really got us on the ropes.
And also, we're talking about somebody who committed murder and their sentencing, not their rights. We're literally talking about a criminal who literally is guilty of triple homicide. And you think we're talking about it, therefore, we're akin to racists against black people. This is just the minds of these people.
White men are not a minority.
We're not even talking about rights.
White men are not a minority, mate. Okay.
Yeah.
Anyway, listen. He's distracting me. Sorry, Kara. Kara, so can you tell me what happened on that day when you and what were you doing there?
Yeah. So just very quickly, Dana Rivers is white. One of his victims, Patricia Wright, is black, and her adopted son Benny is also black. So let's dispense with this nonsense. Yeah. Okay, so
so a white person killed two black people, and you know we're yeah, supposed to pretend.
We're supposed to Anyways. Pretend. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah. Sorry. Go on, Kara.
And he will probably be held in a women's prison, disproportionately black women incarcerated in that prison. So yeah. Anyway. So when I left in November, it was announced that the next phase, which is to consider the insanity argument, would be on December 5th. And so several of us regrouped very quickly and decided to have an action on December 5th. And we did that and we got those banners. They had the Women's Declaration International logo on them. One of them said, Dana Rivers is a man. And the other one said, no men in women's prisons. And we went as planned to the courthouse and we stood on the steps of the courthouse and we gave a few talks. It wasn't particularly celebratory. We were mourning the deaths of this lesbian couple and their child. And it also coincided with the anniversary of the massacre of feminists or young women in Montreal. So we we noted that. And then one of our speakers read a list of the names of people who have been murdered by trans-identified men for whom there's no day of remembrance, right? Mm. We don't have a social day of remembrance for people who are murdered by trans-identified men. So she read some of their names and we had a moment of silence for those murder victims. And we could see at the time our opponents were sort of gathering. They were quiet. They were kind of in the corner not doing anything, in part because there weren't many of them, and in part because we were on the steps of the courthouse where there was a law enforcement presence. And we decided to take our banners to a public area, which is by a lake, and we know it's a fairly heavily populated area. And we went there and we just stood in silent solidarity with lesbians and incarcerated women and held our banners. We weren't doing anything. We weren't saying anything.
You don't have to even point that out. Of course you weren't.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And then this woman came up, for anyone who's seen the video, this woman came up to us and it was very interesting because she said, okay, I can acknowledge that Dana Rivers is a man. And then she continued, but given how violent prisons are, why should she be held in the men's prison? So it was really interesting, right? She was obviously, she was engaging, I think, in good faith, and she wanted to talk with us. And we just said to her, you know, thank you for your questions. You're welcome to visit the website of Women's Declaration International. But for today, we're just here to stand in solidarity with lesbians and incarcerated women. And she accepted that, and she was about to get on with her day and continue walking her dog, when out of the blue, this mob of maybe 8 or 10, mostly men, just came up and attacked us. I know that a man threw a raw egg at the side of my head and it hit, and I had raw egg dripping down here and I had eggshells all over the place, and it was all very disgusting. It was minimally painful. It was very disgusting. And then they ran away. And you know, a couple of us had pies thrown at our faces. And then they tore our banners out of our hands. And we learned later that they took the banners to somewhere where they burned them. And I just think this is so interesting, right? These men are showing up for convicted murder and arsonist, Dana Rivers.
Yeah.
Rivers was convicted of arson. And they show up for him and they celebrate by burning someone else's banners. It's mystifying to me that they think this is a good look for them.
I know. Well, you know, as we always say, you know, or as I was saying earlier, the you know, they can always be depended on to do the very worst thing possible. And I think the more people see this stuff, I mean, I'm really sorry it happened to you, Kara. It's absolutely disgusting. It makes me so angry. But, you know, like, I just think that displays like that probably peak a few dozen people at a time, you know. So
definitely peaked the woman who was there, or
really
even do it, right? They did it. They peaked her.
Oh, good. I'm delighted to hear that. Kara, is there anything else we need to can I just ask, did you follow it up with any police? Did you ask the police to step in or anything like that? And what did they say?
We did. We called 911 right after it happened. They expressed interest in doing something about it, but the men had run off so quickly. And there was nothing to identify them. You know, again, this is another point. All of these guys show up in hoodies and masks and they're completely unidentifiable.
That's to protect them. That's to protect them, Kara. Didn't you? Don't you realize they're the ones who are in danger if anyone sees their faces? I cannot believe that these scumbags have been allowed to get away with it for so long. Listen, Kara, this is that Seinfeld routine where they have dinner and he asks them to make dinner for some sort. Let's do dinner sometime, and he keeps kind of claiming this isn't a dinner. This isn't a dinner, right, Kara? I was going to get you on, and I'd love to get you on for longer and talk more about the wider view of things at the moment, because it's so very interesting. But unfortunately, I have to rush off. So will you come back soon?
Well, yeah, thanks so much for having me on this impromptu.
Yeah, no, I love doing it that way, actually. I'd like to do that more often. And the other thing, Kara, is will you do Wine with Women, or have you already done it?
I have, but I would love to talk with Helen again anytime.
You're muted, Graham.
Sorry about that. Thank you so much again, Kara. Artie, thank you too. We will leave it there, and I'll see you. See you next week, Artie, and Kara. I'll see you very soon.
Yeah, thanks for watching, everybody. Like and subscribe, and all that jazz. And we'll have a Christmas one soon.
And please ask Elon Musk to bring me back on before he brings on any more Nazis. You know, it's beginning to get insulting. All right, bye-bye.